And now the next session is going to be very exciting. I mean, the Millennium Development Goals deadline is 2015. The Sustainable Development Goals are their named successor. And the next session is going to talk about the future and where to next. And someone who's directly involved with raising awareness of the Sustainable Development Goals is our next special session speaker. She's a fantastic woman. She is a former aide to British Prime Minister Tony Blair, a former managing director of Freud Communications, and probably particularly interesting for the fact that we're here in Ireland. She's somebody who worked with Richard Curtis and alongside Bono and Bob Geldof, who we've heard so much from this last few days, on Make Poverty History. And the new project she's going to be talking to us about is something she's also doing with Richard Curtis. So please welcome to the stage, Kate Garvey. It's a force field.
So I'm actually here to introduce someone else, because I don't do the speaking in this, but the reason I am here today is to talk about something that I believe in, which is that next year, 2015, is an extremely important year. Indeed, I believe it could be the year to change the future of our people and our planet. Why? Because our leaders will be writing their to-do list for a generation. The new Sustainable Development Goals, succinctly named, will be announced in September at the UN, and then in December, the climate summit will take place in Paris. The actions our leaders take at these summits could mean we see an end to extreme poverty by 2030, and are the first, and we become the first and last generation to live with climate change. But in order to make this happen, we must raise our voice. And so I would like to introduce you to someone who has already raised her voice in Brazil. She has started a movement and caused a change from the ground up. She has shown how individuals can make a huge difference. To tell you more about her initiative and why she is adding her voice to the 2015 campaign, please give a warm welcome to Alessandra Orofino.
For having me. As Kate said, 3 years ago, I co-founded an organization called Meu Rio. Sorry, let me go back there. Yeah, and Meu Rio is an organization based in the city of Rio. And what we do is essentially provide citizens with technologies and ways of working that can help them change issues and places that they care about in their city. One of our most popular platforms is the pressure cooker. That's panela de pressão in Portuguese. And the pressure cooker allows anyone in the city of Rio to start a campaign choosing a very specific decision maker in the city from a huge database of decision makers and pressure them to change something in the city. You could pressure them over email, or you could leave your phone number and have our little robot call you and connect you to the decision maker. That's one of the things that we do. A different platform that we have developed is called Multitude. There you go. And that platform essentially helps people put the talent together and help their neighbors advance their own causes. So if you start a campaign on the pressure cooker, you might get the help from a designer or a researcher or an activist or someone else in your neighborhood that can help you amplify your message and have a real impact in your community. In this past 3 years, Meu Rio really grew. To a network that is now comprised of over 170,000 citizens of Rio. And the large majority of them are young people, just like most of us here today, age 20 to 29. That is one in every 15 young people of that age in Rio today. And these young people have helped and have worked together to do some extraordinary things. Many of them partner with a mother, Jovita, who started a campaign after looking for her daughter who had disappeared for over 10 years. In the process of looking for her daughter, she found out that Rio had no centralized intelligence system for solving missing persons cases. What that means is that a parent who's looking for his or her loved one would have to go to every single hospital, to every single homeless people shelter to try and look for their loved one without having any data that would allow them to go through that process in an easier and more humane way. Jovita started a campaign. She got over 16,000 people to email our Secretary of Security. And many months later, he complied and actually started creating an intelligence system to address such cases. It was open to the public just a month ago. This is her campaign page that she created, and our Secretary of Security's face is right over there. Poor man. We have also helped children save one of the best public elementary schools in Rio. This was a campaign started by an 11-year-old student using the pressure cooker. When she found out that her school was going to be demolished by the Rio de Janeiro state government to build a parking lot for the World Cup right before the event happened, and she got more than 20,000 people to protest, either through a petition or through a crowdfunding campaign that helped us cover the cost for the students to attend the public hearings that would be where discussions around their school would take place. We also had almost 2,000 people sign up as guardians of the school using this really cool tool that we developed where we put a webcam monitoring the school 24/7 during the summer months when the children were away and were really afraid that the school would be demolished then. So you could watch it and you could sign up to receive SMS alerts. And when we SMS'd you, you would come to the school and physically block it from being demolished. Many months after that, with many conversations and a lot of fight, we actually got the school to stay in place. And as you know, the World Cup already happened. The school is still standing. Thank you. Thank you. That, yeah. Well, I just give people tools. They do these amazing things that you're seeing, not me. And I am here today because for this community, and I believe for many communities around the world, 2015 really is a big year. And not just because our world leaders are talking to each other and meeting in really fancy conferences and having good food. 2015 is a good year and an important year for us because the decisions that these leaders make provide us with a real blueprint, a real commitment that we can use to hold our governments accountable. As you just learned, in 2015, the new Sustainable Development Goals will be unveiled to the world in September. And we are also going to see a big meeting of world leaders in December to talk about climate change in Paris. Those two meetings are crucial because the results that come out of them will give people like Bia and Jovita and other thousands of Millhill members and people around the world something that they can use to really advocate for change in their communities. See, when we go talk to the mayor of Rio, for instance, and we tell them that we need basic sanitation in the city, he might come to us and say, listen, we can't do this. It's too expensive. It's going to take us 100 years to get there. It's just not feasible. But if we have a document that was signed by our home country, where we make a commitment to really eliminate extreme poverty by 2030, we can tell him, listen, we made a commitment to do this, and we're not going to get there without basic sanitation. You made a commitment to do this as a political agent in the city that helps us advocate effectively, that helps us talk to the press, that helps us really advance change in our own communities. And that's why anyone who cares about this world should really be watching these two events closely and the results that come out of them. And that's also why I was honored to participate in a coalition of organizations around the world that are working on something called Action 2015. The goal for this coalition is twofold. First, we want to make sure that the goals that are unveiled to the world in September next year are actually ambitious, clear and exactly what we need. We want to make sure that when these world leaders assemble in the UN and tell us what the plan is for humanity, that we look at it and say, okay, this is exactly what we need. This is exactly what we have been waiting for. This is something that we can use. So that's the first goal. The second one is to make sure that once these goals come out, that people know about them. Clearly, the first thing that we need to do is change the names, because SDGs is a terrible brand, but we're working on that. once they come out, we want to make sure that people like Millhill members, people who are in their communities trying to advocate for change on the ground, actually know about this amazing instrument, this tool that they can use. And in order to make sure that the goals are ambitious and that the goals are famous, we have been thinking about some really cool activations that we're going to do next year, and I hope you see them and participate in them. We want to do something with 15-year-olds on the 15th of January of 2015. Where they advocate for change in their own communities. In many Latin American countries, the 15th birthday of a girl or boy is a really big deal. And we want to make sure that these 15-year-olds feel empowered to actually attack some of our generation's biggest challenges, like poverty, like climate change. We also want to project amazing messages on landmarks. This is a picture taken on the Global Day of Action for Climate Change in September. And our team helped organize the march in Rio and did this stunt. We want to use radio and TV to get this message to reach every corner of the planet. We want to do live events. And finally, we want to make sure that we are in every medium. We're going to use technology, we're going to use radio, we're going to use the newspapers, we're going to go into schools, we're going to be on TV. You're going to be hearing about us, and I hope you're also going to be a part of this, because that's the crucial part. You know, the last goals that we had, the Millennium Development Goals, really did help us achieve some amazing things. Since they were unveiled to the world, we were able to halve child mortality, we were able to halve extreme poverty. And I believe that if we make sure that the next goals are as ambitious as they can be, and if we make sure that people around the world know about them and know how to use them for real, specific action in their own communities, then we can actually eliminate poverty in our lifetimes. We can make sure that our children and grandchildren are living in a world that is a little more humane, a little more dignified for everyone, and that is also viable for generations to come. One really important piece of this, though, is the legacy, right? After we make these goals really ambitious, after we make them really famous, how do we make sure that for the next 15 years, our leaders are actually working to meet them? How do we make sure that we're holding them accountable as they should be? Right, and how do we make sure that this year of 2015 is marking the start of a whole new deal for the people and the planet? With my team, the way that we have found to do this is by expanding our model. So we want to make sure that 2015 is the year where we reach 15 other cities in the world and start providing people around the world with tools that they can use to pressure local governments to advocate for change in their communities. We just opened up an application process for people who want to be founders of a Millhill-like organization in their city. It's going to be super cool. We're going to bring you or them to Rio for 5 weeks and train them and provide them with everything they need to really have, you know, a lot of impact in their own city. If you want to apply, it's ourcities.org. But most importantly, what I want to know is what everyone will do. Like, this is one thing that we thought we should be doing. And even if you don't take part in this, even if you don't want to be a founder in your city, even if you never see this in your lives, I am sure that there is something that you can do in your community to make sure these goals are ambitious, to make sure they are known, but most importantly, to make sure they are the start of something big, to make sure that they do not become a document that we put in some drawer somewhere and never look at again, because that's really the crucial piece. And that's, I think, how I'm going to leave you today. After we stop talking, or I stop talking, and you leave, and you talk to people in the hall, or you send an email home and say how amazing the event has been, or I just want you to take 1 minute and take a deep breath and think deeply about what you will do. What you will do to help us achieve this really ambitious plan, what you will do to make sure that your community is impacted in a positive way, in 2015 and in years to come. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sweetheart. So something that's really important is these MDGs have become the, we think are going to be the SDGs, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. You heard Paul talk about them as well. But at the very first One Young World in 2010, there were delegates who drew our attention to the fact that the way religion was being abused and used, as a delegate put it yesterday, as an excuse for justifying murder and mayhem and, God help us, even rape, was just a wrong thing. And that the whole issue of religion being abused in that way had been left out of the Millennium Development Goals. And yet, when they looked around the world at the then 39 conflict regions in the world, most of those conflicts, religion was being used as a dividing line. So these delegates, ambassadors, as they then became, decided that there was a Millennium Development Goal that was missing. They went to talk about it at the United Nations. It has now been included in the Sustainable Development Goals process. And here to tell you about it is one of those One Young World ambassadors from Nigeria, Anjara Bada.
Hello, good evening, everyone. How are you? My name is Ajara, like Kate said. I'm a One Young World ambassador from Nigeria. I came here first in 2010, spoke on the Global Health Panel. I'm a nurse, that's my background. But I was deeply touched, like Kate mentioned, on the panel interfaith dialogue, and calling for an end to violence in the name of religion. So we took that campaign with One Young World ambassadors from 2010, particularly Catherine Peter, who's the One Young World ambassador from South Africa, who's now the One Young World director, and Bogdan Gogulin, One Young World ambassador from Estonia. We took that campaign to the United Nations. We got an audience of the Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, and we ended up in something called United Nations Alliance of Civilizations, an initiative of the government of Spain and Turkey that was speaking to the Samuel Huntington's theory on the clash of civilizations, which you guys are very well aware of. Anyhow, we campaigned for that goal for a very long time. In 2012, right about 2012, it was very clear that the Millennium Development Goals were already 12 years old, and it was very difficult to add another one to those goals. But luckily, at the Rio 20 Summit, the SDGs were born, like Alessandra talked to you about already, and these goals were going to take over from the Millennium Development Goals. So now, as the goals stand, there's 17 of them, and probably about only 10 of them will make it, as you know at this time. And there's a goal on building peaceful societies. But on that particular goal, the goal number 17, it doesn't speak anywhere to ending religiously motivated violence. So we got a goal to speak on building peaceful societies, but not on ending religiously motivated violence. And in light of ISIS, Boko Haram, and the things you've been hearing about today, we do need a global agenda that works on ensuring interfaith collaboration for peace and working towards ending religiously motivated violence. Why does it matter? I went to Nigeria a couple weeks ago. I was speaking to a friend of mine working on the MDGs, and she said to me, maybe we didn't necessarily do well on the MDGs, but for the first time ever, New York, Lagos, and Dhaka were working together on a particular set of goals, and that's what mattered. So the MDGs gave a framework for people to work together, and that's what the SDGs will do. So we need to get the right set of goals onto the Sustainable Development Goal agenda. So we have 1 year till next year to work towards it. We're going to blog about it, tweet about it, write about it. You all can do something. We need a very clear goal next year. In 2015, when they meet, we need a very, very clear goal that deals with combating religiously motivated violence. Thank you all. I appreciate your help for next year. Thank you.